Hello everyone, welcome back to Vietnam. Today we're going to be doing another shorts episode in the Strike Fighters 2 series. Today we'll be flying an RF-101C reconnaissance mission from Udorn Royal Thai Air Force Base along with the 45th Tactical Reconnaissance Squadron. Today's date is the 1st of March, 1968. We'll be performing a tactical reconnaissance flight over the Vinh patrol boat base. Our call sign for today is Tomahawk, and we will be two RF-101C Voodoos. Takeoff time of 7:50 in the morning. We'll be over the target around 8:04, and then we'll be returning to Udorn at about 8:26. Okay, let's proceed to the loadout. Not a lot going on today since we are a reconnaissance aircraft once again. You can see our pylons are empty. We're not going to be equipping any ECM pods, but we will have two 450-gallon drop tanks. We're painted in the Southeast Asia camo, and we are Tomahawk 1, 48,000 pounds takeoff weight. Now here in the map, let's look at our route that we're going to be taking today. Here we are at Udorn. There's the 45th Tactical Recon Squadron. You can see the three other squadrons that are also assigned here. We've got the 555th, the triple nickel, RF-4s, and F-4s from two other fighter squadrons. We'll be taking off and heading east, crossing over Laos at a cruise altitude of 20,000 feet. As we come into Vinh, we're going to drop down to 1,600 feet, firewall the throttles, and proceed over the target area as fast as we possibly can to avoid any ground fire or interception. After that, we'll egress out to the southwest and climb back up to 20,000 feet, and then head back over Laos and back into Thailand on the way home. It's going to be 184 miles straight line distance, so it'll be a little bit more with these bumps that we've got, probably about 200 miles between us and the target, for about a 22-minute flight, and then return flight as well. Looking at the roster. Once again, we'll be taking our intrepid birdman, Billy Crenshaw. He will be Tomahawk 1. There we go. And our wingman will be Second Lieutenant Carl Tuck in Tomahawk 2. And that's all we've got for today's briefing. So we're going to head out to the tarmac in pre-flight and get our Voodoo ready to fly. We'll see you out there. Welcome out to the runway here at Udorn in our F-101s. Beautiful, sleek aircraft. Look at the way these guys look. I love this plane. F-105 is still my favorite Vietnam fighter, but I just love F-101s. I just like the way they look. Even though they weren't a combat plane, they were still extremely useful, and I just like their lines. So, we're going to get ready to go here. Brakes are off. Full power, afterburners are engaging. Now this plane has a very, very high stall speed, so we're going to be looking at a rotation speed of 200 knots. And there's 100. There's 150. And 200 knots, just as we're passing the tower, pulling up, positive rate of climb. So let's bring those gear up, and the flaps. I want to get some speed so we can pull up and climb up over these mountains here just off the runway. We're going to be climbing to 20,000 for cruise. There we go, and we can see the tops of these mountains, so let's make the turn and proceed to our first waypoint. And Lieutenant Tuck is airborne. It'll be a nice, clear day out. Get some good photos of the patrol boat base in Vinh. Now, like I said, it's about 100, well, it's a straight line shot, 184 miles between Udorn and Vinh. with the couple of jogs that we have. Our flight plan is a little bit longer, so it's, like I said, it's probably about 200 miles. We're going to be cruising at Mach 0.9, so it's going to be about a 22-minute flight time from here to Vinh, and then about a 22-minute flight back. So it'll be about a 44, 45-minute flight once again today, assuming nothing goes wrong. And as we're climbing up the altitude and admiring the sleek lines of this aircraft, let's talk a little bit about the history of the RF-101 and the F-101 in general. Today's aircraft is the McDonnell RF-101C Voodoo, nicknamed the 101-er by its crews. The F-101 had its beginnings way back in 1946 with McDonnell Aircraft. Now, this was long before the companies merged with Douglas to become the McDonnell Douglas that we know and love today. With World War II just over, the U.S. Army Air Force put out a contract for new bomber escort designs, and McDonnell produced the XF-88 Voodoo for submission in 1947. Though its top speed was disappointing, the XF-88 still beat out designs from Lockheed and North American. However, the detonation of the first Soviet nuclear bomb in 1949 changed the Air Force's priorities to interceptors instead of escorts, and the escort contract was canceled in 1950 before the Voodoo was put into production. When reports from the Korean War showed that bombers were still very vulnerable to enemy fighters, the Air Force reissued the contract for escort fighters in 1951. McDonnell submitted a larger, more powerful version of the XF-88 design, which ended up winning the bid. The designation of the aircraft was changed to the F-101. The Voodoo first flew in September of 1954 and entered service in May of 1957. With the arrival of the B-52, Strategic Air Command once again saw no use in fighter escorts and lost interest in the Voodoo, which could have meant the end of development. Instead, Tactical Air Command, a separate Cold War entity, was attracted to the aircraft, and the F-101 program continued, now reconfigured, into a fighter bomber that could carry a smaller tactical nuke. The F-101A set several speed records in 1957, including a top speed of 1,207.6 miles per hour, the New York-LA time at 3 hours 36 minutes, the return trip at 3 hours 7 minutes, and the total round trip record at 6 hours 46 minutes. The F-101C was introduced that same year, 1957, and featured more powerful engines, an airframe that could withstand more G's, and improved fuel capacity. The F-101C never saw combat and was replaced by the F-4 Phantom in 1966. The F-101B could be considered the definitive version of the aircraft, with 479 produced, more units than both the A and C models combined. The B model was such a departure from the baseline Voodoo that McDonnell wanted to redesignate it the F-109. Deploying in 1959, the B model had a two-man crew with an elongated canopy, a larger improved fire control radar, larger engines, the removal of the four internal 20mm cannons, replacing them with four AIM-4 Falcon missiles in a rotating internal bay. The B models all went to squadrons of Air Defense Command on continental defense duty to intercept Russian bombers. By 1972, they had been retired from the regular Air Force and were then moved to various Air National Guard units, replacing aging F-102s. F-101s continued in Guard service until 1982, when the final Voodoo was retired from Tyndall Air Force Base in Florida. That was not the end of the Voodoo's career, however. The B model was also the only export model being sold to Canada as the CF-101. 132 CF-101s were sold to Canada in 1961, amid controversies involving both the cancellation of the CF-105 Aero program and resistance to deployment of nuclear weapons on Canadian soil. The CF-105 Aero was the aircraft that had promised to be the crowning achievement for the Canadian aviation industry, and had been cancelled amongst political infighting in favor of Bomarc nuclear-tipped anti-bomber missiles. This was only one part of a series of controversies on whether nuclear weapons would be allowed into Canada at all. The Kennedy administration was claiming that Canada, was not upholding its NATO requirements and was pushing for nukes in Canada, leading to accusations that the US was using this as an excuse to interfere with Canadian government. The internal political fighting finally became so bad that the Canadian government collapsed in 1963 as several leading members stepped down in resignation and new elections had to be held. In the midst of all this national upheaval, the sale of F-101s was arranged from the United States to serve as continental interceptors. Eventually, the aircraft would be armed with the AIR-2A Genie, an unguided nuclear rocket designed to be fired into groups of bombers to destroy them en masse. These missiles were also part of the nuclear weapon argument in Canada, and finally were allowed in under a strange and carefully worded agreement that went out of its way to neither acknowledge nor deny nuclear deployment in Canada. Instead, it skirted the issue by declaring that the missiles were U.S. Air Force property and were under the custody of detachments of the 425th Munitions Support Squadron, which would deploy to Canada's CF-101 bases. None of the missiles would ever be fired, but Canadian Voodoos routinely ran intercept missions on Soviet Tu-95 Bears that would stray too close. The CF-101s continued as Canada's primary air defense aircraft from 1961 until 1985, when it was replaced by CF-18 Hornets, and all nuclear weapons were returned to the United States. The last Voodoo flight ever was by Canada's last CF-101F on April 9, 1987, as it flew to be placed on display at CFB Cornwallis in Nova Scotia. The Voodoo's only combat contribution was during the Vietnam War in its photo reconnaissance role. The RF-101C became operational in 1958. It had up to 6 cameras and a reshaped nose that replaced the radar and cannons of the fighter version. The RF-101 carried 3 camera compartments, one in the nose tip looking forward, another in the nose behind that with 2 side-facing cameras, and a third bay just forward of the intakes with cameras looking straight down. The RF-101 could carry a variety of camera types, but most often used 2 specific models. One was the Chicago Aerial Industries KA-45 optical camera, which took 4.5 by 4.5 inch negatives and was fitted with a low altitude 6 inch lens cone. The other was the Fairchild KA-56 panoramic optical camera, which took low altitude horizon to horizon images with a prism lens. Both cameras also saw service with the RF-4s and RB-57s. The term optical camera distinguished the type from infrared cameras, which were far less common but were found to be more useful for night and bad weather photography. The RF-101 also carried photo flash cartridges. Air Force aircraft used these cartridges to provide light for optical cameras at night. After being ejected from an aircraft, they flashed for about 1/5 of a second. The smaller 1-pound M112 cartridge flashed at 110 million candle power, while the larger 4.3-pound M123 cartridge flashed at 265 million candle power. Voodoo saw action during the Cuban Missile Crisis, and then were one of the first aircraft deployed to Vietnam as early as 1961. The first Voodoo casualty happened in 1964, when the first F-101 was downed by anti-aircraft fire. F-101s flew over 35,000 missions in the war, during which 39 aircraft were lost, 27 over North Vietnam itself. Only one was shot down by a MiG-21, all others were lost to SAMs and ground fire. The Voodoos of the 20th Tactical Reconnaissance Squadron from Udorn Royal Thai Air Force Base, along with the RF-4s of the 11th and 14th Tactical Recon Groups, accounted for more than 80% of all recon flights over North Vietnam. RF-101s would transit and then leave the target area at full afterburner, at low altitude to stay off enemy radar screens, and speed was the Voodoo's only defense. With no weapons hanging into the slipstream, the aircraft was exceptionally aerodynamically clean, and normally the Voodoo's speed meant that it could outrun and escape SAMs and MiGs. But in 1967, they were equipped with ALQ-71 ECM pods to enable them to operate at medium altitudes and away from the ground. The added drag of the ECM pods was enough to slow the planes down and make them vulnerable to interception, meaning that they now required a fighter escort. The F-101 was 67 feet long, 18 feet tall, with a wingspan of 40 feet. It was powered by two Pratt & Whitney J57 afterburning engines with a max speed of Mach 1.85. It had a total range of 1,320 nautical miles with a ceiling of 58,000 feet. The RF-101 was finally phased out of Vietnam in 1970, being replaced by RF-4 Phantoms. However, the aircraft stayed in service with the Air Force until 1979. The final American F-101 was a B model that was retired by the 2nd Fighter Weapons Squadron at Tyndall Air Force Base, Florida, on 21 September 1982. All right, you can see that we're approaching our initial point. There's a huge melee fight out over the ocean just east of Vinh. There's all sorts of MiGs and F-4s out there going nuts. You probably saw that I set our cruise pressure ratio at 2.5. We talked about pressure ratio in the past. Again, that's a measure of the pressure in the intakes versus the thrust out the back of the engine. This is a good way to measure the total thrust output of the engine because it takes into account the pressure changes with altitude and things like that. So it's constant no matter what altitude you're at. You're not looking at fuel flow or even thrust, because that can change depending on your altitude. As you go higher, jet engines are more efficient. There's the city of Vinh off to our right, so we're gonna bring back the throttle now. You can see that we've been cruising at 0.9 Mach. We're gonna get ready to descend for our photo run. There's Vinh. PT boat base is going to be obviously on the coast, right near where all of the docks and whatnot are. I want to make sure that the actual strike groups get there first, because obviously we don't want to take a photo of a target that hasn't been hit. And here comes the A4 strike groups now, and there's an F4 strike group also. Looks like they've made it past all of the MiG interceptors. And they're bombs away. Bingo, and there's a second hit out. Oh, you can see AA fire coming up from the dock district. That's going to be AAA fire that we're going to want to avoid, and we are going to do that by using our speed. A nice clean aircraft. Just got those drop tanks. Let's see where those closest MiGs are. Okay, 10 o'clock, 25 miles. Alright. They're far away. They're not going to be a factor. And we hit our initial point. Here we go. Powering up the front cameras there. Or the whole camera package, but you can see the front cameras are transmitting into that little radar scope there. And again, we're getting down to 1,600 feet, and we're just going to go as fast as we possibly can. We're going to be supersonic as we fly over Vinh and the PT boat base. Lieutenant Tuck is right on my wing. He'll be taking photos off also as a backup, so even if one of the aircraft gets shot down, we'll still have the information that we need to get back to planners. Alright, Jungle's coming up to us fast here. Selecting full afterburner. 1,600 feet. We're going to be coming right over those AAA guns. Hopefully they're not even going to know that we're here until we're gone. There we are, just hitting Mach 1 right now. And we can see those craters banking out over the ocean. Mission successful, turning to our egress point. Chevy 1, wind ground. Copy, earth ground. Mission successful, we can secure those cameras. We'll turn those off. We're just right at Mach 1 here. I'm going to pull up. We're going to zoom climb back to 20,000 feet. You can hear the dogfighting is still persistent out over the ocean. People calling for help. Fox 1s, those are F-4s still firing their Sparrow missiles. And people are still getting kills out there. Oh, whoa. A single flak shot was directed at us. We'll do some light jinking here just to avoid any gunners getting a beat on us. But we're going to be out of here pretty fast. We're up to Mach 1.2 right now, full afterburner still. Draining that fuel out of our drop tanks. And they're empty, so we'll give them a jettison. And we'll drop back down to cruise pressure of 2.5 here. And that's it. That's it. We were in and out of our target just like that. Pretty damn fast. Mission successful. So far, no damage. You can see we've got so many friendly airplanes over Vinh engaging with MiGs. I don't think that we're in danger of interception, but we'll keep an eye out just in case. And that's that. We're just going to head back to Udorn now, another 20 minutes, back to home base, and then we'll be doing our landing maneuvers. In the meantime, let's talk about Udorn Royal Thai Air Force Base. I know I've talked about it in some of the other videos, but the shorts are not intended to be sequential, so if someone's coming in and just seeing this episode, I don't want you to miss out on any information that I've talked about before, even, you know, because it's relevant. So let's talk about Udorn. Udorn is a Royal Thai Air Force Base in northeast Thailand that was constructed in the 1950s. In 1959, a civil war began in neighboring Laos, and Thailand feared it might spread into their own country. In 1961, Thailand began allowing the U.S. to secretly use five of its air bases to fly recon flights over Laos. The bases remained under the control of Thai officers, though U.S. security police assisted with base security. U.S. forces at Udorn were under the command of the 13th Air Force, headquartered at Clark AFB in Luzon, Philippines. After a major defeat of the Royal Lao Army in 1962, it was feared a communist invasion of northern Thailand was imminent. President Kennedy ordered U.S. forces into Thailand to deter any such attacks. Marine Squadron VMFA-332 deployed to Udorn with 20 A-4 Skyhawks, along with helicopters from HMM-261. Later in 1962, the situation in Laos had stabilized, and the country had declared its neutrality, so all Marines were recalled and departed the airbase. However, by 1964, the U.S. was back in full force as Udorn became a frontline U.S. Air Force base from 1964 through 1976. The first squadrons on base were deployed from their home in Okinawa, and were the 39th Air Division, flying RF-101C Voodoos, and the 555th Tactical Fighter Squadron, flying F-4 Phantoms. In 1966, the 432nd Tactical Reconnaissance Wing was created and became the permanent resident of Udorn, and included a variety of squadrons. Aircraft included RF-101s and RF-4s of the 20th, 14th, and 11th Tactical Recon Squadrons. F-104s and F-4s were stationed there with the 13th, 435th, and 555th Tactical Fighter Squadrons. Several Special Operations squadrons were stationed at Udorn as well, including C-130s of the 7th Airborne Command and Control Squadron, and the 4th Special Operations Squadron, which operated AC-47 and AC-119 gunships. The most unusual resident was the 54th Weather Reconnaissance Squadron. Three C-130s and two F-4 Phantoms that flew weather modification missions over Laos, North Vietnam, and South Vietnam. Operation Popeye made use of cloud seeding, the dumping of dry ice or silver iodine into clouds, to create torrential rainfall in an effort to wipe out infrastructure and slow enemy logistics, especially over areas of the Ho Chi Minh Trail. Their motto was Make Mud, Not War, and Operation Popeye lasted from 1967 through 1972. Secretary of Defense Robert McNamara was aware of the program and supported it, though it was so classified that when he retired, the incoming Secretary of Defense, Melvin Laird, was not informed of it. Henry Kissinger and the CIA continued the program without authorization from Laird, who was insisting to Congress at the time that such a program didn't exist. In 1972, during Operation Linebacker, five additional F-4 squadrons were assigned to Udorn. In 1973, with the Paris Peace Accord signed, American squadrons began rotating off the base to return home. The last Air Force personnel left in 1976, and the base returned to full Royal Thai Air Force control, and is still home today to the 231st Attack Squadron flying Dassault Alpha jets. Udorn was also famous for being the Asian headquarters of Air America, and its forerunner, Civil Air Transport. CAT began operations out of Udorn on September 11, 1955, and used three Curtiss C-46 commandos to deliver food and emergency aid into various parts of Indochina. When CAT became Air America, Udorn remained the hub of the company's far-flung overt and covert operations. Air America continued to operate out of Udorn until 1974. Just playing around here using only rudder to change our course and keep us leveled out. All right. There we go. We can see Udorn right there, that little brown patch. Field elevation is 3,600 feet, so we'll be approaching at above 4,600 feet. Pattern altitude, which would be 1,000 feet above the ground, would be 46. We want to come in above pattern altitude, come down the runway, and then make our brake and overhead 360 for landing. So somewhere probably around 5 or 6,000 feet. Not too worried about being exact this time out. And approach radar has us. They'll be directing us to contact the tower soon. Now, this aircraft, or at least the model of this aircraft in this game, has an extremely high stall speed, around 200 knots. And it also has a very, very bad tendency that if you're at slow speed and you pull too much angle of attack, about plus 17 degrees, I've noticed, the plane will have an accelerated stall and will go into an unrecoverable spin. So, it's really like tap dancing on eggshells with this plane at slow speed. So what you're going to see is I'm going to keep the speed way, way up for this, much, much faster than we're used to. My approach speed is going to be about 250, and pattern speed is going to be about 300. We're used to our Navy planes approaching much, much slower. But not this plane. This one, we got to keep it nice and fast so we don't crash. So just be aware that's what you're about to see here. And coming over Udorn right now, there we have it. Brakes out. And braking. That speed's coming down. We're getting dangerously close to 200, but we gotta get the gear out. A little bit slower for flaps, come on. There we go. Perfect. Now that we're in landing configuration, rolling out on downwind, I'm going to get that speed back up to around 250. You can see even here how much I'm pulling the nose up just to keep level. Coming back up to 300 knots almost, and I want to slow down and make this turn. This is where it's most dangerous. The slow speed pulling back too much, exceeding 15 degrees of angle of attack, will put this plane right into a spin, and there is no recovery. You gotta eject or just ride it in. But we're looking to be in pretty good shape this time around. Coming up on runway heading, things are looking good. We're about 250 knots. Gonna look for a touchdown speed of around 200. Got to peek way up to see around this this bulbous radar scope here. But if I look up a little bit, then I can see over it. And there we go. Still on 250 knots. Looking good for runway 36. And we'll just grease this baby in like a rocket, though. She is so fast. Floating a bit, and there we go, touchdown. Air brakes deployed, and we pop out the drogue chute for maximum deceleration. Drogue chutes, of course, were standard equipment still at this time in the 60s and 70s on all of these aircraft that had a very fast landing speed. So daily operations to have to deploy the drag chute on landing and then have to repack it before every flight. And Tomahawk 1 is clear of the runway. Got those navigation lights off. And there we have it. That's a pretty successful mission. Well, very successful mission, but pretty quiet for us. We'll see you in the debrief, and we'll see how it went. Welcome to the mission debrief. Not a whole lot to talk about since it was just a recon mission, but we can see Billy Crenshaw is promoted to First Lieutenant. That's exciting. We got an outstanding success with a score of 2,000. Flight time was 42 minutes and 57 seconds, so 43 minutes. And what did I said 44 minutes when we took off, when I did flight planning. So there we have it. All Tomahawk's aircraft were safe. And I hope you enjoyed this recon flight with the RF-101C. We'll see you next time for another Strike Fighters 2 Vietnam adventure. See you later.